So on the theme of suitability is fit for intended purpose, okay? So methods need to be fit for intended purpose. Definition is the method does what it is expected to do. And it should be supported by good controls all the way around, such as in-run suitability checks, system calibrations, having the appropriate references, again, to be in a state of control. Because if you got a great method with bad instrumentation, it's worthless. Your fit for intended purpose theme should also be in synchrony with targets or specifications. So you clearly want to have a method that's sensitive enough for what's important to the process chemistry and the manufacturer and for the regulations. And sometimes, too, the question comes out, do I want my methods to be weight percent with a reference standard involved, or do I just need to be concerned with relative abundance, which some people call area percent? And again, that question really is guided by what are your needs. The intended purpose theme also has to be changed, or will likely be changed, in step with the evolution of a project. So you can imagine that early on in a project, you will be working with an enabling route for your chemical, and then as things evolve, you'll be, eventually deciding on a manufacturing route. So it's very likely your impurity profiles can change, and you're going to have to make some method adjustments. When we're looking for methods to be fit for intended purpose from a contract perspective, we often have situations that fall into one of two categories. Either we're given a method from the customer or we're asked to develop them de novo. So in the case of when we're given methodology, we still, or developing actually, we need to have relevant references, markers, and samples. And if there's any method information at all out there from the literature or scratch notes from a lab notebook of some kind, which really isn't good GMP, but nonetheless, and also specifications and targets. So you need to know what you're aiming for in your method development. If you need a sensitive method, you've got to develop a sensitive method. Well, I mentioned that as a contract facility, we have a lot of customers that give us methodology, and they will claim, they will claim that their method is great, or they may say, we think it's okay, but let us know. So what we have to do is evaluate it. And again, you need to have all the relevant markers. You need to know your targets, like I mentioned in the last slide. And it's exactly what we do. We familiarize, we refine it if necessary, and we do some kind of qualification. So as a contract facility, we always engage in good communication, which means that if we are to make changes, we'll explain what we were given, what we changed, and justifying it. That's more customer service than science, but that's how it's done. Going back one slide, I just wanted to mention that Regis has a method development process. It's not something I could get into in detail, because that could be a separate talk. But that's an optional slide, and if we really want to dig deep, I will get into that later. So I got a couple more slides on fit for intended purpose. And one of the big themes that affects us as a contract facility is that we'll be asked to just follow the USP. So we get told, here's a project, and the USP has the method, so you're going to be fine. And it has to be realized that if you find a monograph with, let's say, an HPLC method, you have no idea what was the synthesis that is involved with that method. So if what you're making has a different synthesis, you would have a different impurity profile, and you need to check that out. You may even find you have to change the method. And so the trail of activities that you would be involved in is you look at the USP method, try it out. It may fail on you, then you go about your development. But all along the way, you justify what it is you're doing and why. And also of interest is that the USP monographs tend to describe columns, well, for HPLC methods, they describe columns in a very categorical manner. And so the method may say, use a C18 column. And as chromatographers would know, there could be hundreds of these C18 columns out there, each with their proprietary specificity, selectivity. And which one do you use? Well, you have to try it out. So you can't just hope to use a USP method once, try it, and say, it's good. You need to challenge it. We do see a lot of HPLC methods that are in the USP that are limited to strength testing, and TLC seems to still be around as a impurity method. As I have seen things in like the pharmacopeial chat, when I do look, it appears as though the industry wants to try to modernize everything so that TLC really isn't a primary method anymore. From our own perspective on projects, TLC would not have been acceptable to keep as the only impurity method.
Well, sorry, what was that last line about generics?
Okay, well, thank you for that. When it comes to generics, and especially in an industry like ours, where we could be asked to participate in a generic campaign, the client may actually say, well, follow the USP. And then we could challenge and say, but we need to do some development. And then the conversation goes, okay, we're going to make it by a synthesis that looks like this, A to B to C. And it could be that the research going into the compendial method had a pathway that went F to E to C. And so same product, but different history, different potential impurities. So it is relevant for that, because you can't just assume, again, that the USP is going to be your method. And in a similar track, for gas chromatography residual solvent assays, there are general methods described. They may be pretty good for starts, but you can't assume that they're just going to work for you and serve you all the way through. So I wrote a few examples of things that can go wrong or that you have to check for. Okay, the test material can cause interference, and you have to be aware that your solvents for your synthesis have to be considered in the context of other reagents present, if your material will break down, or if your material will itself interfere. So you really got to check out specificity. And also spike recovery. You may be looking for an easy solvent like ethanol in a certain drug substance material, but for some reason there's interaction and you can't get the ethanol to escape into the headspace or get into the column. That's an oversimplification, but it is a situation we run into a lot. Since we religiously check for spike recoveries, we sometimes see things don't work in the easiest set of conditions, and then we got to go further.